Good afternoon, Cloud Native community, and welcome back to London, England. We're here coming to the back end of day two of our 3 days of coverage in London, England, here on theCUBE. My name's Savannah Peterson, here with Rob Strechay, as you've probably come to expect at this point at this show.
Absolutely.
We've done the last three, you and I, the whole time.
It's been great, and I think what's been great is really just getting here and the vibes from the community and the ecosystem and just the energy of KubeCon is like, Cloud Native Con is fantastic. And one of my favorite shows of the two favorite shows of the year, now five or whatever it is.
We got to start branching out. We're just NA and this side of the world. I wonder what we're going to do next. Who better to talk to us about that community that you're talking about and the companies that benefit from open source technology than Brian Douglas? Thank you for taking time today.
Thanks for having me. I'm happy to be here.
Yeah, we are stoked to talk to you. I'm really excited to talk to you, actually. So we had Jim from the Linux Foundation on yesterday, and he was telling us that the estimated market value of open source software is $9 trillion. Pretty wild data point, and powerful data point, because I think there's sometimes a little bit of a tension between open source and doing things for free, and the value of that. You are the person in the ecosystem side that gets to work with a lot of these companies, hear these stories, and I cannot wait to know what's going on. So tell us some of the trends that you're seeing. It's got to be such an interesting time to have your job.
So my role is head of ecosystem, and I work with end user specifically within the foundation. And the way we sort of describe end users is, if the cloud was deleted, like, how much of that $9.1 trillion would affect your business? Like, would your business continue without the cloud, or would it just completely scratch to a halt? So trends we're seeing right now is, like, very popular here in the EU with telcos now. They've been around for years, but now they're getting on cloud native technologies and really just adopting it with, like, the new NeoNephos Foundation. Things, obviously, AIs. It's big. It's a verb.
It's a
noun. It's an adjective. It's all out there as well. But then with the EU, like, data sovereignty as well. So, like, being cloud native helps you knowing where your data is going to be, or your users' data is going to be as well. So that's been remarkable. But some things we've been seeing in AI, and I'm just sort of rambling. But
no, this is great.
I heard a note, and I failed to actually go and look up my own. Do my own research, but as far as all the GPUs that are out and that are provisioned for folks to be leveraged and doing AI, we're looking at, like, less than 10% usage. And I think a lot of people are actually looking to do something with AI.
Wow.
But they're not actually deploying stuff just yet. They're just sort of hoarding, I guess, if you will. So what's going to be exciting in the next 6 months is seeing people actually leveraging some of that technology using cloud native.
I think that's a really good point. Rob, are you hoarding any GPUs?
I am not hoarding any GPUs, but I know people who are hoarding GPUs. What I think is interesting, though, is there's so many projects that are going on. I actually had the pleasure of doing a panel, helping run a panel for data on Kubernetes yesterday, and we actually asked the audience, how many of you are doing training of AI? 600 people in the room, 10 hands went up.
I believe it.
And then we asked about inference.
Wow,
and
that's,
I think,
all, 10?
I think it was, 10, and then I think there was maybe 15 that were doing inference. So we broke it down that way, and we looked at it, and I think, what to your point, I think a lot of people are looking at the stack. So do you hear from the ecosystem that, hey, what we're trying to do is really focus on usability, ease of use, because to me that would seem like it helps them in their day jobs, as well as when they're here doing the open source type stuff.
And that's what we're seeing right now, is a lot of folks are using your GitHub Copilot and your cursors or Windsurf to, you know, test the waters. And you get to, like, a certain extent of, yes, it works, but, like, am I going to use this in my behind a firewall for my engineers? Like, maybe yes or no. You know, it's up for a debate. But I think what we're going to see route is a trend of more controls. You can now leverage some of the big hyperscalers and big clouds to go ship and deploy your own solutions. But again, low usage and for GPUs at the moment. We need to get more tooling in the part of the tool chain to be able to be cloud ready. And I think the one thing I'm seeing right now in the conversation I'm having at this event is MLOps is a thing. So, like, we have this pillar of ML data. Everyone's got their technology that's working. Then you have these, like, developers that are shipping projects on the weekend with, like, vibe coding, like, that exists. But then what's cloud native? What's AI native? And I think we're going to see more of a melding of those two situations together, where ML's got their perfect ops situations to, like, dissect a bunch of and infer a bunch of data and, like, do some data science on that. We've got the cool Vibros that are doing really good stuff on this side. Now we need to build things that are cloud native, and we're seeing this with like K-Serve is now getting some more maturity. We're seeing some other stuff that within Sandbox and the CNCF in the architecture ecosystem. It just needs more adoption. So we need more people to, our end users, to start using this technology for real features, for real use cases, and things that are ready for production and not just for toys and hobbies.
Do you have any examples of those end users that are the early adopters and achieving success and a little bit of ROI so far?
Yeah, there's a lot of folks. The challenge is that we need more people to talk about their stories. So we had the Ant Group today. They were one of our end user case studies. And they specifically, they were the top end user award today. That's sort of mixing what the two things.
Congratulations to them.
And they have some really cool things they've been doing at the Ant Group and sort of solving AI. And like the individual, Richard, he's actually based in Hangzhou, which is like the city of DeepSeek. So it's like right there in the middle of like all what's happening. So like there's a lot of cool things that are happening right now, and like I'm going to be working with him later to see if we can get some case studies from the Ant Group. But we also have like a bunch of other folks who are doing really good work. I think I used to work at GitHub. I spent 5 years working at there. They obviously are known for Copilot at this point. They're a company built on Copilot. A lot of really good ideas and thoughts at Microsoft of building AI. And like my role is going to be basically becoming best friends with these folks and providing standards and best practices on how to engage with this.
I appreciate that your job is to befriend smart people.
Yeah, I like to think I'm pretty friendly. Yeah.
Yes. And how does it go? Because like again, you had Apple up on stage earlier today, and they were talking about how they're using some of the open source with as part of Apple Intelligence, a lot of the actual security actually layer of that as well for over the networking. How do you get and help encourage those folks as well? Because they're using and they're buying and they're building and so there's sometimes a vendor and there's sometimes an actual end user of the technology as well.
Yeah, that's like I can't speak for Apple specifically in their details, but like they're doing really cool stuff and like getting an AI agent, getting LLMs to work on your phone, specifically their SLMs, so like small language models. Like you don't want to burn a hole in your pocket while it's like dissecting your messages and trying to do things securely. But you touched on a really good, interesting part about the security thing and networking. That's the thing that's not being talked about in the whole AI engineering phase.
Right.
And that's very important when it comes to cloud native. And that's why we need folks within this community and at KubeCon to really start thinking about those stories and building tools that are GPU ready to be able to like very clearly like build for this technology. So I don't know if the term is AI native. We're going to stick with cloud native for now, but like there are AI native solutions that we should be thinking through that's going to work on our infrastructure, on our metal, and like more of those stories are just going to help us get to that point.
I can imagine you're having a lot of conversations with members of your community, your end users here too, about what this future is going to look like when it plays out. If you could tell everyone, well, leverage the platform that we're on right now to tell all of these potential end users or existing end users maybe of different parts of the CNCF ecosystem who are now starting to think about AI, something magical, wave your little magic wand and they all of a sudden understood something, what would be that thing you wanted to tell them?
Yeah, the one thing I would tell you, and I don't know if you guys will edit clips after this and have like the nice little piano music and like, this is like the more you know segment at the end of this.
Yes!
But the idea is like, open source is built on storytelling. Like if somebody didn't, I shared a story in the keynote when I was on stage about Pixar. First success of open source was Bruce Perens solved a bug within Pixar's technology to get their editing working or their sort of animation software working for Toy Story. It wasn't Toy Story yet, it was sort of early concepts of it. But it was called Electric Fence. And he just threw it up on a message board and shared that story. And that was this eventually caught waves and other people who edit and do animations got to leverage that success. So I think what it is like open source, cloud native, like we only as good as the information that's readily available and shared. This is why we have a non-competitive environment where everyone is represented on stage and within these conversations that can share these stories. And there's ways to like, you don't need to share like private information and stuff like that. We just want to talk about the tech that you're using. So we've got over 200 projects within the CNCF. Mm-hmm. If you're using 10 of those, like there's a story of how you compiled those and made that work to be AI native and AI ready.
Yeah.
Like that's a story that we should really start getting out there. And I think we're ready for that? Like, again, we want to be production ready. We want to be confident that this is secure. Would it be data sovereignty and like think about how we're leveraging the data, how it's being trained. And we don't want the government to tell us how to do this. I know it's been a thing. It was SB 1047 as of recent. No longer
regulation is definitely a conversation.
Yeah, but like we should be in those stages, in those conversations. And like if you see something, say something. Let's bring the community along for the ride.
I guess that's an interesting thing because you are an advocate for the ecosystem as well. Is that something that you see as you're bringing back into not just CNCF, but the Linux Foundation? Because we had a number of people on and we talked about, hey, the umbrella of the Linux Foundation is doing stuff for CNCF and for its members that, you get leverage out of that. Is that one of the big things?
Yeah, it's a huge benefit. Like folks, like I've got neighbors and like I'll talk to my neighbor about his lawnmower and be like, hey, I've got issues with these corners. Like what are you using? How are you doing this? Like share some knowledge. When I was I was an engineer in San Francisco for a small startup. I remember we had a hard time working with payments. And it blew my mind when my CTO was like, who do we know that are friends that work in the city that have solved this problem? And we literally just had folks come like for a happy hour and we chatted. And we were able to solve our little small rinky-dink problems for a small startup by just talking to some of our friends at bigger companies. And like, it's not necessarily like big companies talk to small companies all the time, but some folks want some mentorship. We want some roadmaps of like how people have done this stuff. And it really just comes down to like, it doesn't have to be competitive. Like we can share stories, we can talk about how we are shipping cloud and how we're basically getting adoption and like what are the trends publicly that we're seeing or also privately. Like those are all things that like, this is what I love about this community, and this is true already for the end user community, is they're doing this.
Yeah.
So if like you're not an end user, or if you just show up to the events and like maybe you have like 10 tickets of your staff that are coming, probably consider joining officially as a member to start getting involved in some of we have a TAB, which is our technical advisory board. We have TOC, which is our technical oversight committee that oversees project end user engagement as well. And then obviously we have a governing board for higher level members to really steer like what's happening. And like, we just had a meeting just about an hour ago just talking about AI and what's happening. So TBD on that stuff.
How big is your team internally, out of curiosity?
That's a good question. Internally, I've only been on this team for 34 days, so that's a hard answer. I could say the Linux Foundation is about 300.
Mm-hmm.
For the CNCF, I'd say sub 50, sub 40. We have quite a few contractors, but
a lot of people contribute, but y'all do a lot with a small amount of resources because of that culture of collaboration, like you're talking about. I mean, it's not just about the size of the company, like your startup example, which is a good one. It's also about the diversity and the power of that diversity of thought in this room. I mean, something like of the 14,000 people here, I believe there's roughly 100 countries represented. We've got a bunch of different people thinking about solving these problems differently and helping really raise the water level together, making what these end users, like you're talking about, these bigger companies, these Apples or whatnot, they're able to build more sustainably, smarter, and then help everybody out. I mean, it's so interesting how some of these companies will go head to head in very, very visible aspects of the economy and in the world and in the business game. And then when it comes to stuff like this, it's like, okay, let's work together so that we make sure this is all more secure for everybody.
Yeah.
Or when your phone deep links to my financial firm, that this is safe. It's just cool. Is there anything that has surprised you in the last 34 days of having this job that you weren't necessarily expecting, perhaps?
Honestly, what's really surprising is how friendly people are. Like, the folks that, and it's, in reality, like these are the folks that are spending their time, and like when we talk about these, the TAB and the TOC, these are volunteer roles. Like these are folks who have a day job, who didn't show up for an hour call, a virtual call to basically chat with a bunch of other folks from different organizations.
Yeah.
Like folks are willing to share and tell and showcase. And it's been really exceptional to see from high level VPs to like staff, principal engineers participating in these conversations. And really just like rolling up the sleeves and like really thinking through like, hey, how do we plan for what this evolution of AI is? And I think that if you were to ask 20 years ago, like we didn't have Kubernetes 20 years ago.
Right.
Like we had a whole different world of like how we were doing ops and sysadmin stuff and like managing networks.
100%.
10 years ago, we got Kubernetes. It's been so much easier. And it's been a wave of how we've been able to extend and really just like ship products and infrastructure so quickly. Now with the advent of things like AI, and again, we'll keep harking on this AI thing, but it really is like what this is actually unlocking. And it's not just productivity benefits, but it's also like knowledge sharing and transfer, but also how quickly we can develop feature development to support our customers and end users. Like it's a bit unreal.
It is a bit unreal, and I'm always just so impressed. I mean, you know, you jokingly did a little tear. I actually cried on the show last night talking to the Deaf and Hard of Hearing Working Group at CNCF, yeah. The BIPOC initiative, and I actually just saw Malad walk by, who's a part of that group as well, and gave him a little smirk over your shoulder. But there is this incredible openness, and I'm not just trying to be, no pun intended with it being open source, but it is this desire to really help everybody get on the same page rather than these siloed innovation and siloed development. It always makes me happy. All right, I've got two more questions for you. When we're hanging out in, let's call it Amsterdam, next year, next spring, what do you hope to be able to say then that you can't yet say now?
Yeah, I would love to say, I mean, I imagine this is going to be true, but we're going to have some pretty clear playbooks and pretty good ideas of how you run AI at scale.
Yeah.
I think we've gotten the last year a lot of good stories around multi-cluster environments, and that's been great to see. Like people are now being able to do multi-cluster and also multi-cloud, because that's been top of mind. I come from two companies ago where we had a multi-cloud setup. We were also another rinky-dink startup as well, and it was like very innovative in how we were able to like pull over and like move over to different clouds for the benefit of credits. Mm-hmm. But in reality, like there is a lot of necessity of like, we need to have a standards, we need to have like a playbook on how can we start being, I think I'm just going to start writing blog posts around AI native, because I think that might be the term I go forward with. But yeah, being AI native, but also AI ready. So I would love to, next year, like this is just, it's a box that's been checked.
That's going to be awesome, and I think I support your decision on the blogging. Yeah. But I do think you're right. I think we'll get closer to a standardization, which equates to a simplification of the ability to deploy and start to scale up quicker. My final question for you, since we casually joked about it before we went live, who do you think is the most underrated player in the NBA?
Underrated player in the NBA, man, that is a good question. Man, I mean, I'm a Warriors fan, so I'm.
Let's go.
I'm biased to a certain extent.
So you would say Jason Tatum then?
Jason Tatum. You know, Jason Tatum gets a lot of hate for the team he plays, but also because he's a bit mild mannered.
Yes,
I'd be quite honest. So yes. he's great, but honestly, I'd say like I love Jaylen Brown. Like
Ooh.
I think
Jaylen Brown is awesome.
I think he is great at what he does. Also, adjunct professor for Harvard. Like
the amount of work he does in the community.
Yeah.
Doesn't get talked about half enough. That he's really plugged in Boston, which is fantastic.
Yeah, so I'm pro smart NBA player. So, you know, basketball IQ, but also IQ is good. IQ.
And a bit of EQ there mixed in
EQ
as well.
A
little bit of sensitivity and awareness.
Yeah.
No, I think
Big
it's
fan.
Awesome. I love that. Brian, I had to sneak in some NBA stuff for you just because. And I was a sideline girl before I was an enterprise tech sideline girl.
Oh,
so this, we're
I get
all speaking the
same
center language.
For,
yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. I was up at 3 a.m. two nights ago watching the Warriors play. I'll probably be up again watching NBA here.
Very nice.
Love that. Brian, thank you so much for taking the time.
Yeah, pleasure. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, and thank you, Rob, as always. Hope all of you are enjoying these fun chats about end users, the open source community, and the NBA here on theCUBE from London, England. We're at KubeCon and CloudNativeCon. My name is Savannah Peterson. You're watching theCUBE, the leading source for enterprise tech news.